Kubernetes architecture. See, Kubernetes is basically used for orchestration. This we understood. That means what? In Kubernetes, there are built-in components which are doing all the plumbing job which is required by our microservices based application, basically our containers. That plumbing job is done or split between two components. One is called as master components and the other is called as worker components. So there will be one computer, one node in which all the master components are going to run. One copy of this is sufficient. Unless we plan to go for availability, in such case, we need to run parallel multiple copies for the sake of high availability. But only one of them will be active at any point of time. So a set of master components are deployed in server node. And like that, all other machines in the cluster are supposed to have the worker components. So a cluster is made up of one master and multiple worker nodes. Master can be more than one, but only one is active at a time. The only reason why I would go for more than one, to ensure high availability. So what are these components? What is the role of each one of them? That's what we need to understand. That will give you an insight on how actually Kubernetes is working. A single master host will manage the cluster. The complete cluster is managed by this host. They are responsible for global decisions. Now, what are these global decisions? Scheduling of containers, which here actually we call it as pods. And if there is any kind of downtime, detecting those downtimes. And if there is a downtime, after detecting, what action should take? Responding. So all the tasks which are related to scheduling, detecting and responding to the cluster events is the job of these master components. Very important point to be noted, the master components are responsible for managing the nodes. But even if the master components go down, your workload will not go down. Your workload, your container, your application is actually deployed on these worker nodes. Temporarily, the management will go down for these worker nodes, but your worker nodes will not stop working just because managed master node is down. The manager, this is the manager. But if manager is not present, it does not mean the team is not working. The team will still continue to work. Just that the management will not happen because the traffic to these is not coming via the manager. The traffic to these will directly come. That's what we need to understand now. So what are the different components in master? We have API server. We have got controller manager, scheduler, etcd. These four important components. And now they have added cloud control manager so that it can control certain cloud services. So what is this API server? Any kind of instruction which I from outside wants to give to Kubernetes, my point of contact is going to be API server. We are going to make restful calls of Kubernetes and they would reach API server directly. Any REST call I make, all of them will go to the API server. So we can say that it's basically a front end used by the users or the tools which we are going to use for managing the Kubernetes. There is a tool we are going to use called as Kubelet. So Kubelet will send all its instructions to API server only. Sorry, not Kubelet, Kubectl. Kubelet is different. I always get confused. But this is Kubectl. Kube tool is a Kubectl. Kubectl is a tool. We are going to use this Kubectl tool for all management of Kubernetes cluster. Any instruction which I give through this will always go to the API server only. Yes, API server otherwise understands REST REST, it is a REST API. You can use that REST API and program it in Java and C Sharp also if you want to. So if I want to deploy some new application, basically some container, my request will go to the API server. That's the role of it. That's the heart. All communication between all other components is initiated only via API server. In other words, I'm never going to directly instruct to all these components. Never. Every instruction is going here only. Then what is the role of etcd? Etcd is a very highly available key value store. For every thing in Kubernetes, there is some metadata. So whether it is a pod or whether it is a service, whether it is a deployment, there is a lot of data which is associated with all these Kubernetes objects. That is nothing but a key and value pair. You can think of JSON objects. So that complete store is managed by etcd. Scheduler. What happens here is, now suppose I send a request to API server. API server, please launch this particular container in one of the nodes. Now what API server does, it immediately talks to the scheduler and checks which of these nodes is relatively free or has less load. It finds the suitable worker node for a newly created pod or service. What is pod? What is service? We are going to discuss. Imagine now some new request has come for creation of a new component. These are components, Kubernetes objects. So scheduler is the one which will help API server in finding out which one is the most favorable worker node to which the request can be sent. So scheduler has complete information regarding the resources available on all the worker nodes in the cluster. Configured service to run and hence is able to decide where to deploy the specific service. So this scheduler is the one which will impact your availability, performance and capacity of the system. It will have complete information about the system. Then we have this controller manager. Controller manager is actually divided into multiple controllers. Controller manager, the name itself has meaning. It's a manager for the controllers. Yes, it is like a control loop. Imagine if you are a developer, while loop. Continuously, it is monitoring the state of the cluster. The controller manager is doing a continuous management of the state of the cluster. So any kind of change in state, it will pick up first. So suppose I want to probably add one new instance of my pod. So I'll do some kind of configuration change and give it to API controller. And that API controller will immediately respond to controller manager. Let it go like this. It's responsible for one or more copies of pods using pod templates. Everything in Kubernetes is through templates. Auto scale pods up and down as appropriate. Doing rolling deployments. All these things controller manager is going to do. Now what are these controllers? Three controllers are there. One is node controller. Now what this node controller does, as soon as one node goes down, one node means one computer goes down, automatically all the pods which are running on that node will have to get recreated on another node. So this node controller will be responsible for noticing, just observation. Oh, okay, this particular node has gone down. It will immediately instruct API controller to take an action because this particular node has gone down. So responsible for noticing and responding when the node goes down. That's the job of node controller. There is a concept of replication. That means one pod, imagine one container, we are going to have multiple instances running on the cluster. If you have catalog service, I may want to run 10 instances on the cluster. Maybe the cluster has 20 nodes, but on 10 nodes only the catalog service is running. Sometimes what happens is we know that, okay, it is not sufficient. So we want to add another 2 nodes or 2 instances of catalog service. So I will do some kind of changes to the pod specification there. The moment I make a change to the pod specification, immediately this replication controller will observe that, and with the help of again API server, it will try to restore the state. From 10, it will restore to, let's say, 12, whatever is the correct number. Likewise, in the whole network, there are services and there are pods. Any kind of functionality is available is through pod, but pod will never get directly exposed to others. Every functionality of pod is exposed only via services. And this endpoint controller is the one which will join the service and the pod. Now what happened? Now let's say pod is running on node 1 with IP X. Now node 1 collapsed. The moment node 1 collapsed, that pod has to be recreated on node 2. And then the service has to be updated that yes, the pod's new location is node 2. That's what is the job of endpoint controller. Endpoint controller is the one which populates the endpoint object, which is responsible for joining the service and pods. So these are three important controllers which are managed by the controller manager, so that the desired state of the cluster can be achieved. Something which is very important to understand, you as a developer or maybe a DevOps engineer, you are never actually interested in these roles. Just for the sake of your knowledge, I'm telling you these, but you are never going to program them. You're never going to configure them. They are all pre-programmed components, which are also deployed as packages. I mean, Docker images, Docker containers. All these are different Docker containers, which are built in, helping to manage the complete cluster. You are never going to do anything here. You are never going to do anything here. None of these things you are going to program. You will only instruct them to do something. And all that instruction, as I said, is going to go via API server. API server will talk to other components. API server will talk to scheduler. Hey scheduler, please tell me, I have received a request for creating a new pod. Where should I give it? Scheduler has information about the complete list of load which is there on different nodes. So scheduler will tell, hello API server, please go to node 5. So API server will send the request to node 5. Controller finds that, okay, suddenly somebody has changed the requirement of pod from 3 to 10. Again, controller will tell API scheduler. API scheduler will again talk to API server. Controller will talk to API server and telling, please increase the number of pods of this particular component. API server again will talk to scheduler. But after talking to scheduler, it needs the complete information that it will take it from here about the spec. So these kind of communication is all happening between themselves and is pre-programmed. That's what I say is plumbing job. All the plumbing job which is required for management of the cluster is taken care of by these components. We as developer would never program them. We will never change their functionality. We use them, or they are internally used. Just that you should know that they are present. That's it. So like now we understand server component, we also have worker component. So the worker node has kubelet, kubeproxy, containerization environment like Docker, and pod. These four things are part of worker node. Worker nodes are the servers. They are also servers that perform work by running containers. So your actual workload of the application is in these containers. And these containers are packaged as pods. So what is pod? What is container? I'm going to follow that. But following are the key components of the node server, which are necessary to communicate with the master component. If you note this line, from API server, there is only one entry point into the worker node that is directly connecting to the kubelet. So any kind of task which API server wants to happen on a particular worker node is communicated only to this kubelet. Kubelet will receive from API server the specification document, which will contain information like what is the image which has to be pulled, what is the port number which has to be mapped, what are the services which is used. All such information API server will give it to kubelet. Kubelet reads that spec and will be responsible for creating the pods on that particular machine. So on that machine, we definitely need to have container runtime, like Docker container runtime, or it can be anything which is equivalent of Docker, not even necessary Docker, but some container runtime is needed over there. Kubelet is the main contact point for each node and is responsible for communication with master. Kubelet takes the spec, which is either in YAML or JSON format. Most of the time it is YAML, which is much easier to use, that are provided through API server. This is important. API server is giving it to the kubelet and ensure that containers described in the pod spec, the specification will have what type of image is supposed to be used. All that it will take care of running on this machine. There is also Kubernetes service proxy service. So all the request actually from internet to the workload has to go via kubeproxy, which you can also place the role of virtual load balancer. It goes to kubeproxy and kubeproxy will then forward it to the respective pod. So kubeproxy plays the role of virtual load balancer. Primitive load balancing is done by kubeproxy. So kubeproxy service, which runs on each node and helps in making the services available to the end user or client. So on every node, we are going to have services and pods, and these services via kubeproxy will become available to the clients. So basically, in short, routing of task is done by the kubeproxy. So these are core important services which are part of worker node as well as of course master node. Let us now focus on something which is the most important for us. What all are the different Kubernetes objects we are going to deploy into the cluster? I, as a developer, has built a containerized application. Maybe I have deployed it as a single host application. I may not have even used Kubernetes initially, but now I decide to use Kubernetes. So what all aspect of Kubernetes I am supposed to have knowledge of to use this cluster? First, Kubernetes pods, the most important of all. Then one by one, we will discuss all of them. Before that, kubectl is the utility program using which all our instructions to API server will be provided. So what operation you want to perform, create, delete, replace, apply, scale, so many operations are there on different objects. All these are different Kubernetes objects. What do you want to create? Service you want to create, deployment you want to create, volume you want to create, all these are objects. The name you can give for the resource, and based on the type of resource, of course, these flags will change. This is the general syntax of kubectl. So kubectl is a CLI tool. Like we used Docker, now we are going to use kubectl in place of Docker. So the syntax for many commands of Docker, what we have learned, would be useful to us in kubectl. So just remember that this is the tool going to be used. Let's now discuss the most important element in a cluster, that is pod. Minimum what you have to ever create in Kubernetes cluster is a pod. Minimum. What is pod? For now, think of pod as a box inside which containers will be created. A pod is a host for a container. Each pod can have one or more containers. Not just one. It can have one or more containers. And these containers can use the storage of the pod for sharing state. So you can actually think of pod as a box. Means I want you to think of a virtual machine. Pod as a virtual machine by itself. It is not a virtual machine. Just for the analogy I am telling you. Because it will have its own IP address. And the information about how to run them, all the containers, how to run, all that will be there with the pod. So when we launch an application in Kubernetes, we are never going to launch it as a container. We are not worried about container. We are worried about a pod. Pod internally will take care of creating a container. One or more. When do we need multi-container pod? The sidecar pattern is the best example of multi-container in a single pod. With sidecar, you can run second container in the pod whose primary to complement the job of the primary container. For example, I may want to have catalog service. But at the same time, on the catalog service, I also want to provide search facility in the catalog. So instead of developing both as one service, I might have developed them as separate service. Catalog management as one service and searching catalog as another service. Both of them, I'll prefer deploying it in a single container. So any kind of side job which is complementing your primary container can be implemented in the same pod. 99.9% of the times, it is advised to run one container in one pod. Querying a pod returns a data structure that contains information about containers and its metadata. All the containers and all their metadata is going to be part of querying the pod. Logging is a good example. Container sends log from the primary controller to the centralized logging system. Any kind of log which is generated, maybe the other container can read it and send it to a centralized logging system managed by the cluster. So any complementing job, try to do it in the same pod through another container. But if you don't see anything, don't force simply, for example, don't put catalog container and shopping cart container into the same pod. Never do that. Let the shopping cart be in a separate pod and catalog can be in separate pod. Because ultimately it is the pod which is going to scale. Each pod is meant to run single instance of a given application. So if you want to scale your application, you are actually going to scale the pod. You will not scale the instance or containers inside that. Whole pod will scale. So if whole pod will scale, automatically all the containers in that will proportionately scale. So who is actually managing this pod replication? There is another component called as replication controller, which will do the job, and we are going to discuss that. Pod is not something which, if destroyed, will automatically get recreated. Pods are not durable. They are not going to survive any kind of failures like memory overflow. Pod will die. Somebody else will have to detect that, okay, this pod has died and hence the containers have died, automatically they have to take care of creating another pod. So they don't survive scheduling failures, node failures, or any other kind of eviction. Memory insufficient, nothing. Pod are not durable. They can die. And if they died, they do not automatically take birth. They are dead. The pod is created. In turn, the containers in the pod are created. All these containers which are there in the pod, you have to ensure that, you should understand that very clearly, they have same IP address, which is of the pod. That means two containers which are running in the same pod cannot listen to the request on same port because their IPs are same. So all containers for a pod will run on the same node definitely. Inside the node actually pod is, and inside the pod container is. Any container within the pod will share nodes network, nodes network with other containers in the same pod. That means their IP address will be same. Both the containers will have same IP address. What they can have different is listening on different port number. So pod A, if you listens on 80, maybe pod B you would listen on 81. Their internal port numbers cannot be same. When a pod is scaled out, all the containers will automatically scale as a group. All containers in the pod can share volume. Remember, we learned volume in Docker. So inside a pod, all the containers which are running, they can use a common volume. And that's one of the ways of sharing data between containers in the pod. A pod has explicit life cycle. As I told you, it will be created, it will be there, and it will be destroyed. And a pod cannot move from one node to another node. It's there, that's it. Created and destroyed there only. They will not be recreated. Same pod will not be recreated. A new pod will get created. That means it will have a new ID altogether. So in short, as a application, as an application deployer, if you look at, when you want to create a container, you have to write pod spec. That is the minimum building block which you have to start with in Kubernetes. Of course, everywhere I said pods are not managing themselves. So we need somebody who can manage the pod. Pods can get destroyed. They can crash, overflows can happen, node failure can happen. So for these kind of things, we have other Kubernetes objects. So as I said already, each pod is assigned a unique IP address. So when we want to talk to the container, we should actually send the request to the IP address of the pod. And within the pod, if two containers want to talk to each other, they can use localhost. That's why I told you earlier, think of pod as one computer. One pod, two containers. One container wants to talk to another container, use localhost. Definitely different IPs they are running on. All nodes in the cluster are expected to be connected to each other and share a private cluster-wide network. There is a private network created between all the nodes in the cluster. So pods can change their address from one node to another node. Not change. Basically, a pod can get destroyed here and get recreated in another location. So definitely, we will never talk to a pod by its IP address. Very dangerous. We should encapsulate the functionality of pod through a service. On top of pod, we will put a service. I'll come to that. Replication controller. What is this? There is a desired state configuration. I will say I need 3 instances of this pod. Who is going to ensure that always 3 instances are there? even in case of node failure replication controller, are responsible for managing the pod lifecycle. It is responsible for making sure that specified number of pod replicas are always running, even in case of node failure. Replication controller is the one which we will use for creating a pod. Replica set is just a replacement to replication controller. Basically, a better replication controller is replica set. It is also responsible for ensuring the desired state. But the way you would configure replica set has an extra advantage, where instead of just mentioning equality based selector, you can use set based selector. What is this equality based and set based selector? That we'll have to look at when we discuss labels. In Kubernetes, every object is given a label and name. There can be more than one label, but definitely a unique name. Labels may not be unique. So I can have two pods with unique names, but their labels can be same. In Kubernetes, we don't use names for one referring one object in the other. Instead, we use labels. And when we use labels, we have got two types of selectors. Name based selector, name equality selector, or set based selector. Some conditions will come into picture here. Here, direct comparison will be done with the value. We'll discuss this shortly. So this is one advantage which replica set gives over replication controller. And not only that, replica set can be further encapsulated by deployments, whereas replication controller doesn't have that advantage. Now, both replica set and replication controller have one big limitation. They cannot detect the change in pod template. So, for example, right now the pod spec is dealing with version 1 of the container image. Version 1 image is used. Now you will tell the Kubernetes, no, I want to replace version 1 with version 2. So what are you going to change? The image aspect of the pod spec you are going to change. That change will not be detected by replica set. If you want to detect these kind of changes, you will have to go for deployments. So deployment controller wraps around and extends the replica set controller. So what is happening here? Replica set is managing pods, but the change in pod spec in terms of its template will not be detected by replica set. Those will be taken care by deployment controller. So what deployment controller does is, when the pod spec changes, it recreates a new replica set and it will remove the old replica set. Rather, the pods from the old replica set will be removed and new replica set will get recreated. I'll show you practically how to do this. The deployment instructs Kubernetes on how to create and update instances of your application. So basically, rolling updates, I told you earlier, those are managed by deployments. Kubernetes master schedules mentioned application instance on individual nodes in the cluster. So the application instances are created. Basically, the deployments controller are continuously monitoring these instances. So same story. This story is all same as, I would say, replica set. Only thing you should keep in mind, deployments are the one which are adding value in terms of providing rolling updates and even rollout. Suppose at the time of doing update, the container is not able to create itself, or it is crashing. Deployments will detect that and it will help us to roll back those changes to previous version. So that is the beauty of deployment set. So in real time, always we are going to create deployments. Deployments internally will manage replica set, and replica set will internally manage pods. That's the life cycle in routine for you people. Routine. This is routine. But pods are having IP, but that IP is internal IP. And that IP also can keep changing. If a pod is crashing on one node, it would get recreated on different node and its IP is changing. So how are then we going to work with the pod? For that comes the purpose of service. We are going to create a service which will enable communication between components within and outside of the application. So there are multiple types of services. There are cluster IP service, which is only used within the cluster. There is external service. There is a load balancer service. There are different types of services. Yes, every service is going to be provided with a unique address. Those IP address are not exposed outside without the, each pod is given a unique IP. The only way you can use that IP is via a service. So services are the one which will allow your application to receive the traffic. It provides an abstraction to your pod agnostic of a specific instance they are running. I'm never bothered about where the pod is. When I want to use the functionality of the pod, I'm always going to send a request to the service. Service will take care of sending the request to the appropriate destination of the pod. So complete discovery and routing among dependent pods, because what many pods will be there, right? You might have 10 instances of the pod running. I don't know which pod should be, should I say, I will never tie up my code in such a way that it will always go to same pod. So the distribution of the load between different pods is also managed by a service. Hence, service enables loose coupling between microservices in the application. Even one microservice running in one container of a particular pod, if it has to talk to another microservice running in a different container of a different pod, the communication must be via service. Pod to pod, you should never communicate, because the location of pod is not fixed. Service through endpoint controller will ensure that the pod location, when changes, suppose this pod got destroyed here and it got created in another location, the service will be automatically updated with a new location. Endpoint controller will take care of that job for us. So ideally, every communication to the pod, whether it is within the cluster or whether it is outside the cluster, compulsory must be via service only. Very important. All this we are talking about the replica set, the deployment, basically are stateless services. But then there can be certain special circumstances where we want to build stateful services, services which would retain their state even if they are destroyed and recreated. So that is achieved through stateful sets. So that is the one which will solve the associated data loss when the pod crash. When the pod crash, everything is gone. And the pods are always supposed to be created in a particular order. In stateful, pod gets consistent naming scheme based on the order in which they are created. So even if one pod gets destroyed, in that order they are always going to be maintained. Yes, internally it is going to use something called as persistent storage volume. That is where the state is going to be stored, because the pods now will have containers which are going to manage state. For example, counter example was required to have a file. So that file will be managed, let us say, by a persistent storage which will be used while creating a stateful set. So stateful set is again a set like replica set which will be responsible for managing pods, so that the state of the pod is recovered with the help of persistent volume in case the pod crash. Actually, pod, again, this is a contradictory state. Pod state will not be recovered. Application state will be recovered. That pod died, new pod created, but both will have common persistent storage. So they will look at the same file system and automatically pick up from there and continue. So useful when you have a group of servers that work together and you need to know each other names ahead of time. Something like Elasticsearch clusters, if created, they are supposed to be in stateful set. Likewise, there is something called as daemon set. Every node, this particular daemon set pod will exist. I have 100 nodes, I'll have 100 pods via daemon set. Each node will have a pod through a daemon set. Ensure that each node runs a copy of a pod. See, if you are taking stateful set or if you are taking replica set, possibility is there you have 100 nodes but only 10 pods of a particular type. But if you want to do some kind of maintenance job, garbage collection job, logging job, monitoring job, right? These kind of jobs, if you want to do on each and every node in the cluster, provision those pods through daemon set. Precisely this is how master pods on the worker node runs. This is how master pods on the worker node runs, such as kubeproxy and kubelet. I mean kubeproxy basically. And kubelet, all these are daemon. They are running on each node, no? So this is how they are actually executing. A job creates, job is another deployment object. Job is basically a task started, must end. If halfway it crashes, it will restart again. That thing is called as a job. And we will specify through job how many times it can retry to complete. Requirement is simple, a stateful termination. A successful termination. The task should be completed. This task A, task B, task C, task D, all completed, then the job is completed. So task A will be done by pod 1, task B will be done by pod 2, task C will be done by pod 3. All this in proper order they should execute, then only the job is said to be complete. If any one of them fails, again it will restart and do it all over. So a pod successfully completes, the job tracks the successful completions. When a specified number of successful completion is reached, the task is said to be complete. Definitely deleting a job will clean up the pods it has created. A job which is regularly scheduled at a regular interval of time is called as cron job. Every day morning 9 o'clock it should execute. We will have to specify a schedule for this kind of job, and that's what is called as cron job. It runs periodically on a given schedule, and that schedule is supposed to be mentioned in the form of cron expression. If you know cron, cron is a format in which we can specify the time interval. On every Monday of every month, for every first Monday of every month at 9 a.m. like that you can mention the cron schedule. A lot of cron expression creators online, you can just use that. It's a special format which has to be provided for creating a cron job. So job only, but automatically scheduled at a regular interval. So these are few important objects. Just at a high level, I have told you about all of them. Eventually, we have to look at each one of them on how we create it, how we use it, what are the benefits and what are the limitations of them. One by one, we are going to cover all these now.